News TV. This is Rogers TV, Mississauga.
Welcome to Left and Right. In most modern societies, civil liberties are things we take for granted, from freedom of religion, freedom of expression, to the Americans' freedom to bear arms. Civil liberties are generally a given in a democratic and modern society. But when do these rights actually present a problem when it comes to morality or common safety? In this edition, we discuss civil liberties. I'm Michael A. Charbon, and this is Left and Right. Welcome to Left and Right. My name is Michael A. Charbon. Today we're talking about civil liberties. I'm joined by two guests in the studio today, Mr. Jagmeet Singh, who is the NDP Justice Critic for Bramley Gore Bolton, and to my left, Mr. Calvin Barry, former Chief Crown Prosecuting Attorney for about 17 years now, has a very flourishing private practice as a criminal defense lawyer. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us today here in the studio. Civil liberties, when you talk about civil liberties, you think about freedom of speech, freedom of religion. In the United States, you also have freedom to bear arms, a little different than what we have here in Canada. Recently, in Toronto, Metropolitan Toronto Police have been experiencing some flack, if you wish, because they're being called out for being racial profiled of particular groups that they're trying to fight crime with, and now being forced to issue tickets to people that they speak to. Where does that line stop? Where does civil liberties stop and the protection of us as a society and the infringement on your own personal rights? Civil liberties are a discussion today. So I'll open it up to you, Calvin, first. You've been on both sides of the law, not from the standpoint of behind the bars or not, but on both sides of the law as a Chief Crown Prosecuting Attorney, which is representing the Crown, working on prosecuting people who have been charged and allegedly created criminal activities. And now you're representing those people. You are a defense attorney. Where do you see our civil liberties either being infringed or reinforced here? The way that they are investigating. Now, I'm going to talk to the former Crown prosecuting attorney, defense attorney, Calvin Barry. Calvin, when you hear things like this about the police stopping people in a particular area and asking questions, does Jagmeet have a point here? Is this good policing or bad policing? What's your legal point of view from that perspective?
Well, I think you can't have people that are being stopped for no reason there's a charter of rights and freedoms, and you can't have improper questioning and just harassing people. I mean, but I think that the police are trying to get it right in Toronto and other police services in Ontario. I mean, I think the thing is that whether you're in a bad neighborhood or a good neighborhood in terms of that type of comment, everybody has a right to be a good goal, amongst their way. Mm-hmm. And if you have a long criminal record, that doesn't mean that you're going to be misbehaving the next time necessarily. And everybody has a right.
Spoken
to
like a true lawyer, though. I love it.
but there are times, and there's a handful of like any lot, teachers, firefighters, the police. You're going to have 5% of police that are going to be take shortcuts and do things that are going to violate charter rights. I mean, from my experience as a prosecutor, I saw it. And I'd either withdraw the charge or not deal with it. But I think they're trying to get it right. And I think that Chief Blair he has an open ear to try to balance everything. But it's tough. You're in a city where there's a lot of knee-jerk reaction. You get a bunch of shootings. Unfortunately, the shootings and killings happen in, say, Scarborough. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, the police are trying to do the right thing. I mean, look at this TTC operator that jumped off the bus and chased the perpetrator down.
Yeah, I want to address that afterwards, but I think
that's sometimes people react, and maybe not necessarily proper, not in accordance with the law and the charter, but every neighborhood should be afforded the same rights and civil liberties as whether you're in Forest Hill or in Scarborough, right. Regent Park,
So, just to continue on civil liberties, joining us from Ottawa on the phone was Natalie DeRosier. Natalie is the general counsel for the Canadian Civil Liberties Association. Natalie, welcome to Left and Right.
Yes, happy to be there.
Thank you, and thank you so much for joining us. Natalie, tell us a little bit about what your position is and how Canadian civil liberties comes into play. You're the general counsel, so you hear all of it from both the left and the right side. And being in Ottawa, you're very close to obviously the politicians and the political trends that are going. What's your position at this point regarding our civil liberties and where we're going and where we've been?
Well, I think civil liberties is a constant obligation in a democratic society. You always have to ensure that they're protected. In a way, it's very easy to forget about why it's important to protect civil liberties and ensure that police officers operate within the law. And it's when we ask them to operate within the law, it's not because we're against policing or against police officers. It's indeed to support their action and support their legitimacy, the way in which if they operate within the law, then I think we are all protected.
But
if
when does it
that they're starting to take shortcuts, then I think there's a danger that we will be, all of us could be at the mercy of abuse of power.
But when does it come to the point that we're hindering their investigative abilities and their assignment to try and root out crime and to spur the criminal activities before they happen when we use this banner of civil liberties to limit their powers and their investigative techniques? We come to a very gray area and a slippery slope where when we start to limit their ability to investigate because it's based on civil liberties, we could be harming ourselves.
Well, I disagree with the way in which you cast this, because indeed most of questions of civil liberties are not saying you cannot do that. They're protecting the way in which an investigation has to be conducted. So that's the way in which it always is. There's no absolute right in Canada, and so it's always a reconciliation of different interests, the interest in investigating crimes, but also protecting the presumption of innocence, the privacy of citizens, and so on. I mean, we could have chosen a different route. You know, we could live in a totalitarian regime where there's very little limits on what the police can do, and they can arrest anyone anywhere for no reason. But we've chosen not to live in that type of society. So that's why we have to ensure that there continues to be reasonable grounds for police officers to arrest someone, as opposed to doing it just on abuse of power.
So Jagmeet, you're the justice critic. You're a minister of parliament. You're actually a rookie, and I say that with great respect. When you listen to Natalie, you're nodding your head. I mean, you're all about this. Then it sounds like you're in simpatico with her.
Yeah, I think Natalie brought up a lot of great points. I mean, I think that the presumption of innocence is a very vital element of the fabric of our society. Having reasonable grounds to arrest someone, I think, is essential. I think more than anything, if you look at in terms of good democracies or good systems of government, as powerful as one institution is, that's the check and balance should be equally powerful. And I think where it comes to the police are quite powerful in terms of an institution. They have a lot of powers. They can take away your liberty. They carry firearms. But in terms of the check and balance, it's not equally powerful. I think we need to have a very equal check and balance to powers to have a very vibrant society. The government has a strong opposition to balance it. Similarly, the police should have a strong opposition or a strong oversight mechanism to make sure that they do the right work, because they have a lot of responsibility.
So, Calvin, you've been a Crown prosecuting attorney before you transitioned to your independent role now, which is a defense attorney.
Right.
When you look at how police stop, investigate, and back up what they've done, where does that fine line occur, where they overstepped their bounds because they presumed, they call it racial profiling, or they presumed guilt, or they presumed a suspicion of something being wrong? When do you cross that line?
Well, you'll see when I was a prosecutor, you know, basically have criminal code, will prosecute, and you had all these resources, and you just go and start arraigning the accused, start calling witnesses, and they have a lot of resources, and they have a lot of power. And so a lot of times I had cops come up to me in the hallway and go, look, I was with a rookie cop, and I think that, you know, he jumped the gun here, so to speak, started searching stuff. I got no problem if you pull this charge. And I'd say, well, you know, A, what he did was break the law. B, there's no reasonable prospect of conviction. and see maybe you can teach them to do it better. I used to teach police at the police divisions as a Crown attorney. And as a defense, it's interesting because, you know, sometimes everybody tries to see a willful that's cops trying to do a bad thing. A lot of time, they're not equipped with the education, the charter, the complex laws in terms of arrest and reasonable grounds. And they're kind of going, look, I'm trying to do my job here. I got it wrong. Teach me better. So I think the public, a lot of times there's a sector that's going, oh, these cops are doing things maliciously and willfully. Sometimes they need more training, just like a lot of people do. And there's only so much money in the pot, and it's not going to go to education. It's going to go to guns and putting cops on the street. And so, you know, that's my experience. But sometimes defense too, you'll get a police officer there that broke the law, infringed some rights, and that cop will go up and just will keep on denying. But fortunately, in our system, which is so transparent, it's usually found out, you know, because you got cross-examination, you got oath, you got a judge there, and these judges aren't on one side or the other. They're down the center, and
that's what we hope.
They're impartial in making the call, like a referee.
You're watching Left and Right. My name is Michael A. Charbonne. When we return, we're going to continue with our discussion on civil liberties. We'll be right back.
The pavement lies before him. A street lamp lights the way. Such steady pace and lane control, his passengers will say. He brought us safe together, and we've had a merry time. While we drank beer and shots, he ordered soda with lime. We hope he always joins us. We enjoy his company. A leader, a warrior, a man amongst men. For short, just call him DD. Thanks to designated drivers everywhere.
Visit arrivealive.org to find out more. Arrive Alive. Drive sober.
Access Peel is about culture. Access Peel is about community.
Access Peel is about home.
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 One, two, three.
This is where I live. This is my hometown, you know what I mean?
The region of Peel is a great place. It's a place rich in culture, and it's a place rich in diversity. With its amazing growth and with this mix of tradition comes change. And with change comes discussion. Talk local. Let's talk.
As a nation, as a province, as a city, we've never done a very good job in connecting to War of 1812. Those who served were not Canadians in any sense. They didn't know Canada as an entity. They were British subjects. These were British citizens. Nonetheless, they, in whatever capacity they served, these are all people who volunteered to serve. They volunteered to serve in a capacity that might put them in harm's way. There was always a sense that, you know, what would happen if, and there was a reality that they the knowledge that they might have to be, and yet they still showed up. The border itself is not an imaginary line. It's something that was fought over and contested. It's remembering what happened. It's remembering the stories of those that came before. It's about understanding our story, and a portion of our story, an untold or unremembered portion of our story, connects to the War of 1812.
Welcome back to Left and Right. I'm joined by Mr. Jagmeet Singh, who is the Brampton Gore Malton MPP Justice Critic. Mr. Calvin Berry, who is a former Chief Crown Prosecuting Attorney and now has his own flourishing legal defense attorney business. And also on the phone from Ottawa, Ms. Natalie DeRoger, who is a General Counsel for the CCL, the Canadian Civil Liberties Association. Natalie, when we left last segment, we just had Calvin, who was speaking a bit about the legal ramifications and how he's dealt with both the Crown and police. And I wanted to give you an opportunity to comment on what Calvin says. So what's your reaction to some of the goings-on that has been happening in our judicial system?
Well, I think I agree with Calvin that certainly I think that one of the guarantees that we all have is that the judicial system is open and transparent, and if you go in front of a judge and indeed there has been some illegality in the way you were treated, this will come out. One of the issues that we see at the Canadian Civil Liberties Association is sometimes it doesn't go in front of a judge, and some of the abusive powers that exist are just going on undetected. And one of the issue is, it's, and I agree with Calvin as well, that it's often, it may not be malicious, it may just be ignorance on the part of some police officers, some do a great job, obviously, and it's a difficult job, and we all appreciate that. But so that's the reason why oversight is important, and also a good culture within the police service, a culture that does not tolerate abuse of power or illegality and does not cover up. And that, I think, there's some work to be done on this. There's still a little bit of an idea or a culture that we call the blue code of silence. When one police officer has done something a little bit wrong, it's very difficult to get information about it and trying to resolve it. So I think eventually, you know, you want to have a policing culture that is accepts accountability as being a good thing, something that enhances good policing.
You know, I find it interesting, and with all respect to Jagmeet and yourself as well, it seems that everybody tries to put the police in a box.
I don't think so.
You don't think so? I find here's a community.
I agree completely with this.
Well, the community that they're enforcing, the community says, we are tired of all the criminal activity that's going on around us. The police aren't putting enough resources. I mean, we have people running around with guns. We have shootings. We have deaths. It's black-on-black crime. We want you to solve this. We want you to fix this. One of the things that Jagmeet said earlier was about poverty and putting more money into the community. These police officers who are out there are trying to investigate, trying to do their job. And under the guise, some would say, of civil liberties, we're limiting their ability to investigate and even ask questions. Now they're issuing tickets, as they would say.
I actually think that the way you're presenting it is actually quite a disservice to the issue and to policing. I once was on a panel with a chief of police that said, you know, when the charter came into play, when we're starting to protect more the rights of individuals, he was worried that his ability to investigate was going to be undermined. And indeed, what he says is after 30 years of the charter, it enhances policing. It gives good policing. Nobody is going to be served if the wrong persons are sent to jail. Good policing, respecting the presumption of innocence, is about ensuring that the guilty are found, not the innocent. And that, I think, is what true security is all about.
Yeah, I think one of the things that Natalie talked about, and I wanted to touch on as well, was the idea of the culture of policing. All too often we look at it and we say, you know, Mike, we say that there's a bad apple, there's a bad police officer here or a bad there. I think what we need to look at is that people are just, you know, human beings. They make mistakes day to day, they might do things right, but the culture needs to be addressed. And one of the things that's in the culture of policing that I think really needs to be worked on is that there's an adversarial nature right now between the police and the community. And that can change. We can change the culture to make sure that the police facilitate and work with the community. And I think that the culture needs to be created that the police use different policing tactics and alternatives to the criminal justice system so that they're working with the community instead of being perceived as working against the community.
And that's what community policing is about. And when I was a prosecutor, these police would go down to the community, they'd have a barbecue, they'd go into people's homes, they'd hang out, they'd wear jeans and not police gun and hat. And they'd try to say, look, you know, I decided when I was 15 I wanted to be a cop and my brother's a firefighter. How can we help? How can we reach out? You don't got a job, you're in a bit of trouble. Maybe I can help you and try to engender some trust in some community. So they say, you know, that guy's not an asshole. He's actually a nice guy and he comes from a nice family. And I wouldn't mind being a cop now from talking to him. And then that 14-year-old kid's going to go and do a good thing. So I think it's a lot about give and take. And you have to kind of, you know, be able to embrace the community. And if you're going to pull, I'm the cop and you're the bad guy, nothing's going to happen. And you're not going to be able to get crime solved. You're not going to have people that can come forward and report crimes. And it's going to be, you know, black and white, and you're the bad guy, we're the good people, and there'll be distrust. So you have to, I mean, it's like in any organization, if a teacher wants to get along with a bunch of, you know, a bad grade 9 class, you sit down and hang out with them, go to the park, sit down in the grass and shoot the shit and try to resolve it. And I mean, it's a partnership of trying to get the end result. Everybody wants to be in a safe community, but everybody wants to get a job. Nobody wants to get arrested. And the cops really don't want to see a guy come back again. They want to see him say, I'm okay now. You know, I figured it out.
Interesting. Natalie, in the next several months, the conservative government under Mr. Harper are talking about building more prisons, making sentences longer, being a lot harder on criminals. Do you see this as a positive thing or a negative thing?
Well, I think one of the issue is to go beyond the rhetoric of more prisons or more longer sentences. Long sentences that are appropriate, that are supported by the evidence, are okay. It's not a simplistic way of looking at this issue. Certainly, I think what you have to ensure is that the presumption of innocence continues to be protected, so it's the right people that are caught within the system, that they are treated fairly, and that their possibility of rehabilitation is being addressed, and so that we don't end up having paying for people to stay in prison at times where it's not necessary. So the positions, I think, have to be more nuanced than simply yes or no, are you against or for longer sentence? It depends on what the circumstances are and what the evidence is.
Would you not think, though, that society now is becoming a little more intolerant of being lenient? We've heard too many stories of too many people who, after serving under 50% of their term of conviction, they're released, the level of sentences really doesn't match the crimes. I mean, we've seen so many times where judges give out sentences that we all scratch our head and say, you've got to be kidding. I mean, do you not think the trend is now starting to go where we as a society want to see more pain for the crime that they've done?
Well, I don't think it's again, my assessment is that there are sentences that are indeed have been going up for certain crimes, and others that recognize that, you know, the jail is not the solution to all issues, because it's a costly issue. It's also one where people come out with less ability to engage in a productive life. So it's not a panacea in terms of solving many of the social issues. So I would disagree a little bit with your assessment that in general the society has rejected rehabilitation as a goal. I think certainly there are people that have not fulfilled their goal of rehabilitation and are back in the system, but others have. And the statistics from Corrections Canada are not that bad.
Well, recidivism is a huge element, though.
The rehabilitation of prisoners was working.
Well, recidivism is a huge element. I mean, you can look at, I believe it's $113,000 per inmate to be imprisoned in Canada. That's a huge amount of money. Yeah. And you look at that and what they're doing in the United States, many states are hiring private corporations that are self-funded, that are building their own prisons, and it becomes a business. The penal business, if you wish, of incarceration in the United States is a new and evolving business because they can do it cheaper, they can do it more effectively, some would say, and they are at arm's length from political interference or what some would say the civil liberties and some of the people who represents the what they feel are the needs and the rehabilitative aspects of a convicted criminal, because it's at arm's length. It's going to be interesting to see if Canada would ever consider that. When we come back, we'll be able to investigate that a little bit more and bring up a couple of other topics that relate to civil liberties. You're watching Left and Right. I'm Michael A. Charbon. We will be back with more right after this.
We have a competition. We have a challenge.
I'm a strong competitor. I know I can do this.
You start hallucinating after.
That's what I've heard.
I'm pretty nervous.
Everything fell into place, and it was really risky, and it just kind of worked out.
This guy emailed me and just said, your music has actually helped me get through a very depressing period of my life.
I come to fight. I don't come to pitter-patter.
I love to fight. You're a better boxer, faster, stronger, we're fighting.
I'm going to take him for as long as I can take him and end the fight. It's just that simple.
Either I'm going to win or I'm going to lose, but I'm coming to win.
When I'm in the ring, you don't want to miss it.
As long as I come in and execute things that I got to execute. he has no chance.
As a nation, as a province, as a city, we've never done a very good job in connecting to War of 1812. Those who served were not Canadians in any sense. They didn't know Canada as an entity. They were British subjects. These were British citizens. Nonetheless, they, in whatever capacity they serve, these are all people who volunteered to serve. They volunteered to serve in a capacity that might put them in harm's way. There was always a sense that, you know, what would happen if, and there was a reality that they the knowledge that they might have to be, and yet they still showed up. The border itself is not an imaginary line. It's something that was fought over and contested. It's remembering what happened. It's remembering the stories of those that came before. It's about understanding our story, and a portion of our story, an untold or unremembered portion of our story, connects to the War of 1812.
Welcome back to Left and Right. My name is Michael A. Charbonne. Joining me in the studio is Mr. Jagmeet Singh, who is the NDP Justice Critic for Bramley Gore. He's a brand new MPP and looking very sharp and very articulate. On my other side, I've got Mr. Calvin Barry, former Chief Crown Prosecuting Attorney, and now is working for the dark side. He is a defense attorney with a very flourishing business in downtown Toronto. And joining us on the phone from Ottawa is Ms. Natalie DeRoger, who is the General Counsel for the Canadian Civil Liberties. Is it Civil Liberties Association?
That's it, yep.
Civil Liberty, the CCLA, Canadian Civil Liberties Association. When we left in our last segment, I threw out a bone to chew, and I was talking about how in the United States, they're making a business out of creating prisons, and then in Canada, it's approximately $113,000 to house a criminal in our penal system, and how the United States now is going to more of a commercialized prison system, whereas they're at arm's length, they could do it cheaper, quicker, faster, self-liquidating, and are being paid by the state. And my question, Natalie, to you was, do you think that's something that we're ever going to come to, and would that be something that you feel, because they're at arm's length to the government, that they don't necessarily have to abide by the same necessary rules that a government institution would have? Do you think that's something that may evolve in Canada?
Well, I think the issue of whether you'll have private prisons or not is not as difficult to resolve as whether what type of conditions will be in prisons. It's interesting that as we're speaking, there is an inquiry into the death of a young woman, Ashley Smith, where you see in the way in which the use of segregation in prisons and the way in which many of the mental health issues of some of the prisoners were not taken into account. So it doesn't matter who runs the prison, mm-hmm. but the way in which prisons are being run have to be looked at and have to ensure that, if people are mentally ill, their needs are taken into account. They shouldn't be in prisons if they're mentally ill, would be my position, but if they happen to be there, then they have to. We have to ensure that they are looked after properly. You also have to ensure, and that's what's interesting, in the United States, eventually what happened is the conditions became so outrageous that the courts have ruled that some prisoners have to be let out. And that's not where you want to be, because you don't want to just let people out without some supervision. It's dangerous.
Well, it's interesting. In 30 years, this is the largest expansion we've had in prisons in Canada. And if you look at the United States, with over 29 million people incarcerated, they have the largest portion of people in prison. So,
Michael, just to build on that point, if I could just add, just if you look at, what's going on in terms of society, the communities that have the highest crime rates are not the communities that have the worst punishments or the longest sentences. If you want to look at reducing crime, we look at some of the Scandinavian countries. They have some of the lowest crime rates in the world, and they actually have some of the most lenient sentences. And in fact, America has some of the worst sentences, including the death penalty, and they have some of the highest rates of crime. And I think that it's a fact. The fact that they have the highest rates of crime, I mean, in the world, it's very well established that America has some of the highest rates in the world.
Three strikes law in California was something that is good and bad. Some would say after you've been arrested twice, attitude, third time you're done. Others would say that a simple drug possession charge can land you in jail for a long period of time.
And this goes back to, again, to our priorities. I mean, if we look at what we're doing with mandatory minimums and forcing judges to say, listen, we can't look at the case by its merits and say, you know, whether someone should go to a probation or do community service, or should they be incarcerated, taking away that decision-making from